Scheduled by now? Some 3 weeks, I think so. Okay, kind of. Yeah. You'll get into the rhythm. Yeah. So the important thing is to show up, right? Because initially when you start off, it's exciting, everything is new, but after that, we have to plug more into the consistency mode, right? So you just show up, and you just, be there, and you know that you would be able to. Still go through with the course, go through with the subjects. Okay, so yeah, so get into that consistency mode. Don't give up, and want to see all of you complete the course, want to see all of you attend every class, right? Complete all the assignments. So if I may say so, push yourself a little bit, okay? And I'm sure it'll be good. Okay. So, Jafina, so it's great. Okay, but she would really prefer offline. Okay, let's see. When things get better, then offline will start. So it's just a matter of time. We'll let you know. Okay, even Sitkenu says he's waiting for the campus to open up. Okay, and Rosalind is saying little bit tough. Yeah, so frankly, Rosalind, it can be a little tough, but you have to press through it. No, that's the only way forward. So commit yourself to this study, set the time aside, and do your part. I'm sure God will strengthen you and help you to complete it. Okay, so that's what I look forward for all of you to complete the course and do it well. All right, so let's pray and get started. Anyone, maybe somebody who has not prayed in this class before, could you please lead in prayer, please?
Praying.
Yes, please. Go ahead, Lash.
Our Master and gracious Lord, we want to thank you for this moment of the day. We want to bless you and honor your holy name. Father, we are committing ourselves into your mighty hands once again, O Lord. Daddy, we pray that your good counsel and your good teaching lead us in this our studies. We pre-commit our Pastor into your holy care, that we pray that you continue to nourish her and flourish her, grant her the utterances that she will make for greater understanding of this course in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we pray for the other students who have not been able to join us, that Lord, your grace continue to sustain them and your grace continue to sustain us also throughout this course so that you will bring it to a successful end. This we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen, amen. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Elisha, for leading us in that word of prayer. We will pick up from where we left in the last class. So far, we have talked about some of the basics of prayer. We've talked about the kind of attitude we must have, the foundations that we need. Faith being one of the essentials. And in the last class, we touched upon believing prayer, where when we pray through something because it's God's will and we pray with great desire, we can actually, see those things happen in our life. We can receive the answer to our asking. Now, we will continue further. So we are basically, building on prayer, our understanding of prayer, how to pray, how to develop our own personal prayer life. So the intention is not to just look at scriptures and say, hey, this is what the Bible says. But as we go along, it'll be great if, you know, we can incorporate these things into our own prayer life. So I encourage you to do that, you know, set time aside, reflect on what you have learned and see how, you know, in your own personal prayer time, you can make some changes or actually improvements and reap greater benefit from what is being taught. So today we will look at a pattern for time in personal prayer. Now, we may set aside whatever amount of time, okay, on a daily basis. Let's say we set aside an hour in prayer. Okay, so what do we do? What do we pray in that 1 hour of prayer? There is a recommended pattern, and this pattern is based on the Lord's Prayer, which Jesus himself taught his disciples. You know, when they said, okay, Jesus, you teach us how to pray. He said, in this manner you pray. Okay. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So Jesus taught them how to pray. So on the basis of this pattern, we will discuss, you know, what and all we can incorporate into that. What, let's say, half an hour if you've set aside, or 1 hour you set aside, or even if you've set aside 5 hours to pray, you know, what are the topics to touch on in the prayer time? Now, this pattern is from what the Lord Jesus taught. And if you study and you listen to sermons of, you know, several pastors, you might find that they are recommending other patterns as well. So now there's nothing wrong with it, as long as you're in the presence of the Lord and you're drawing closer to God, you're spending time with God. It's all beneficial. But this particular pattern, okay, is what Jesus taught. And that is why, you know, we go with this pattern and we recommend it. Now, again, it's not like a hard and fast rule that, you know, in 1 hour, okay, 10 minutes I have to say this, 10 minutes I have to say that. It's not like that. It's meant to direct you. It's meant to sort of guide you, okay? And be led by the Holy Spirit. Don't get, how do I say, like boxed into a very rigid pattern. That's not the intention. This is just meant to help us cover all the aspects that concern us, and, you know, we pray through in our prayer times. So according to this pattern that Jesus taught us, now you all know, probably know the Lord's Prayer by heart. I will just read it for us once. It says, Jesus said, Matthew chapter 6 verses 9 to 13, in this manner, therefore pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, so that is the pattern of prayer here. Now, when Jesus taught us this prayer, he didn't intend for us to just say it as words and not mean it from our hearts. Because don't you think that happens? Even when I learned this prayer, I would just say it like, okay, I'm going to sleep now and I don't have too much time. I just quickly say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom. But is that how Jesus wanted us to pray this prayer? What do you think? To just know it by heart and just rattle it off? Yeah, you can share your thoughts. No, okay, Divya says no, that's not how Jesus wanted us to use it. But I am personally guilty of doing that, and I know of you know, systems and places where that is the norm. You just take that prayer, you just say it, because that's the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, right? Like repetition without understanding, without depth to what Jesus taught us to do. So obviously we've already looked at what prayer is, it's communication, and we don't communicate like that, right? There is a level of understanding. So when we use this pattern of prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, we must understand every aspect of what he's trying to say, and we may not necessarily pray it in those words, but we flow along, you know, that thought. Okay, so we will look at each thought in the Lord's Prayer, and we'll see what it means, how we can apply it when we are speaking to God. So we start off with the very first part here, which says, "Our Father who art in heaven." Okay, hallowed be your name. So till the time that Jesus started preaching about the kingdom of God, I don't think the people had heard anyone call God as Father, because in the Jewish culture, yes, Jehovah God, Lord, you know, King. So they had this concept of God as a great ruler, but the concept as of God being a father, that was something very new that Jesus began to share. And that's how Jesus walked with the Father as well. And we know in the Gospels, there were times when he got accused. People were like, what are you doing? What are you saying? How can you call God your father? This is, you know, blasphemy and things like that. So people accused him for relating to God in this manner. But Jesus is teaching the people a new way to pray. Till that time, they would have done it in a very, you know, how do I put it? Just like the Pharisees, we know, just as a ritual, right? You have your, in the Hebrew language, you just say some scriptures and make your prayers, and you probably had some patterns of prayer recommended by the rabbis. They would just use those things. But Jesus made it personal. And he said, when you're praying, please know that it is personal. And it is personal, very much so, because we are relating to God not as a king and master and Lord alone, but relating to him as a father. Okay, so that is something very, very intimate. So when you're relating to somebody as your father, you know, your heart is open. You are willing to share. You're also willing to receive. So that's how we would go into a time of prayer, knowing that we are speaking to our heavenly Father. Okay, so the whole attitude of prayer changes when you recognize that God is, yes, he's all those other descriptions, but he is also our father. Okay, and any father would want to give good gifts, right? Would want to bring blessings in his children's life. Any father would want to see their children do well. So when we relate to God as a father, you know, the way we pray with boldness, we pray with courage, we pray with assurance, you know, we pray joyfully. So our attitude changes. So begin praying by acknowledging God as our heavenly Father. Okay. And it says, hallowed be your name. Okay. Hallowed is a manner of magnifying the name of God. It is a manner of glorifying the name of God. And earlier, when we talked about prayers of thanksgiving, prayers of, you know, praise, adoration, worship, we said we can take time to do that in our prayer time. So we may want to begin by, you know, thanking the Lord, adoring the Lord, so on and so forth. So that's what Jesus also is teaching here. He's saying, look, relate to God as a father. And the next thing you do is you spend some time worshiping and honoring God, okay, for who he is. So we would exalt him. We would lift up his name, right? We would worship him. We would just recognize him for all that he is to us. And that's how we enter into our time of prayer. So when I'm saying use this as a pattern of prayer, basically I'm saying that let's say we have decided that we are going to pray for 1 hour. We might say, okay, the first 10 minutes, I am only going to praise and thank God. So you get into that. So as the spirit leads, as you feel, you know, in your heart, you just be honest, be genuine, and just thank the Lord. Worship, Lord, I praise you. I give you thanks. And just go on, right? For some time doing the adoration and worship. So we are incorporating that first, section of our prayer pattern. And then you can move on. Then Jesus said, okay, pray like this. Continue to pray like you say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Okay, so we can go into a time after adoring God, acknowledging Him as Father, we go into a time where we ask for God's kingdom to come. Okay, now when you say, let your kingdom come, basically, it means God, your rule, your dominion, your authority, let your will be done, let your purposes be accomplished, you lead the way. So basically, you're kind of giving charge to God and you're giving charge to the way He wants to lead. So when we study a little more about the kingdom of God, so many things we understand. We understand that, you know, in the kingdom of God, scriptures tell us righteousness, peace, and joy. That's the kingdom of God. In the kingdom of God, we see the authority of Christ. When Jesus cast out demon spirits, He said, the kingdom has come upon you. So the kingdom is not just in word, but is in power, right? So things like that. So the kingdom of God has so many, there's so many things to learn about the kingdom of God. But we are saying, God, whatever your kingdom is, you know, it's a just kingdom. It reveals your righteousness and greatness. You are the king of your kingdom, right? So I want my life to be like your kingdom, right? Full of righteousness, full of joy, full of peace, full of the power of God, full of the authority of God, okay? Full of the wisdom of God, the understanding of God, the knowledge of God. So everything that the kingdom is, you're asking that, let it be done in my life, Lord. Now, obviously, we know that heaven has the rule, reign, and authority of Christ established in such a way that there is no interference. Okay, there's no sin in heaven. There's no interference by Satan and demons in heaven. So, uninterrupted, right? As it is in heaven, let it be here on the earth, Lord. So, your kingdom, let your kingdom come. And your will be done. So your purposes, Lord, you're praying through the purposes of God and you're saying, God, the way it is in heaven, unhindered, perfect, right? It is ruling, thriving. I want to see that happen also in my life. Now, when we ask for the kingdom of God to come, now we could spend some time praying for the kingdom to come in every aspect of our life. So I may want to say something like, God, in my will, right? Things, the decisions that I'm making, I want your kingdom to come, Lord. Let it be your will. Let it be done, Lord. Let me make those decisions in accordance to what you want. So I might say, God, in my spiritual life, Lord, I pray, let your kingdom come. Okay? Fill me with your love. Fill me with your peace. Fill me with your joy. So you pray for some time in that manner. Let your rule, your authority, your dominion, oh God, let it come in my personal spiritual life, God. And let it come in my walk with you, oh God, right? And you declare that. You declare that word over your own life and trust that in your spiritual life, in your personal walk with the Lord, you will experience the working of the kingdom, okay? You will walk with power and you will walk with every other aspect of the kingdom of God. Now, I told you there are many aspects, right? So now I finished spending some time worshiping the Lord and exalting Him. Now I'm spending time praying that the kingdom of God would come. I could also carry on by praying the kingdom of God on various aspects of my life. Now I might say, okay, God, in my family, let your kingdom come. Now, for all you know, in the family, there might be a lot of confusion. There might be a lot of, you know, strife. There might be anger and fighting and things like that. But in your prayer time, you're saying, Lord, let your kingdom come. Again, God's kingdom, it's a kingdom of peace, shalom. It's a kingdom of The authority of Christ. So every demonic work, every spirit of strife, confusion, all that you bind in Jesus' name. Let your kingdom come, Lord, in my family. Now, you might want to keep extending that to other things that concern you. So those who are married could pray for the kingdom to come in your spouse's life, right? So you say, Lord, let it be established. Let your rule, your reign, your dominion, your power, your glory be seen in my spouse's life, Lord. I pray that God, you would establish it, and you declare that word over your husband or your wife's life, and then you can carry on. You could pray that for your children. You could pray that for your health. Lord, let your kingdom come. When you're saying the kingdom, obviously in heaven there's no sickness, right? So when you're saying let your kingdom come, you're speaking, you're declaring divine health. You're declaring that over yourself. So you might take some time to just pray for the kingdom to come in your health. You might take time to pray for the kingdom to come in finances, right? In our finances, Lord, is there any lack in heaven? No, there's no lack in heaven, right? It's filled with God's glory, and everything is generous. It's abundant. So it's an abundance that we are seeking. So we speak that. We declare that over our own lives, and we say, Lord, let your kingdom come in my finances, your rule, your reign, your dominion. If there's any lack, Lord, we speak that, it would change into the abundance of God. So every area. So you might take some time just covering different things, work life. A few things are listed in our notes here, and I'm mentioning those. Work life, ministry, we may want to say, Lord, let your kingdom come in our local church, let it come in our city, let it come in our nation. Okay, so you notice how by now, if you have actually taken time to pray for all this, mindfully, I don't know about you, but I think 1 hour will be over. Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, right? So, because sometimes when we pray, like I used to also think, how people are praying for 1 hour, 2 hours. What is there to pray for so long? Isn't it? But Jesus taught us to pray. Why don't you pray regarding these matters? Okay. So we can take it as a pattern. We can go by each of those instructions and then cover many aspects of our life. Okay. So, I'm just telling you, you could just spend even 5 minutes praying on this particular aspect, but it's up to you. So I'm just trying to tell you that when we use a pattern, then it's kind of easier for our mind to be focused. And then we know, we are just going to cover different aspects about God's rule and reign in our lives. So once you're through with it, then you move on to the next point in the Lord's Prayer. So the next point there would be, Jesus said, okay, give us this day our daily bread. Now, for some of us, we might be too spiritual to ask God for any human, natural, earthly things. Okay, and some of us might even think that it's ungodly or unholy for us to ask. I mean, how could you ask God for the things that you need? But we know when we are praying to God and we're saying, our Father in heaven, He is the one who provides for our needs. Okay, so we can bring our natural needs to Him. And that's what Jesus was saying when he said, pray, give us this day our daily bread. Now, daily bread represents our needs. So our needs could be in the area of finances. Our needs could be, in the area of provision of some sort. Our need could be, something else. We need some favor, God's favor upon our lives to move forward. We need some idea from God. So in different ways, whatever natural thing, Lord, I need this. I need this breakthrough. I need this provision. Now you can actually go to God and ask for all those things. Okay, so God doesn't tell us to bypass our needs, because ultimately we have to look to Him, right? He was the one who provided for the children of Israel, So while they were journeying through the wilderness for 40 years, you notice there that he provided manna, he provided quail, you know, the water which they wanted was provided for them. So our God is a provider. So my basic needs, my daily needs, I don't have to hesitate to ask God for what I need. So I can spend some time every day, because our needs keep changing, isn't it? As the seasons change in our lives, our needs also will change. So in that season, what is it that you need? And remember, we talked a lot about this in the believing prayer. So you can believe and you can pray and ask God, and God will answer it to you. Okay, so thank you. Sitkenu is sharing a scripture here. He says, if you ask anything in my name, it shall be provided for you. So yes, God promises the provision, and he encourages us to pray in the name of Jesus. So we can ask God for our daily needs. Now, in this time, you may also want to acknowledge the needs of others. Right, some loved ones, friends, and you say, okay, God, so and so is in need of this, whatever, they need a vehicle for the ministry, or maybe we are praying for our church and we're saying, Lord, we really need a place to meet. So bring our natural needs to the Lord, and he is faithful to answer that. So we spend some time praying for our needs, and notice it says daily, right? Daily bread. So every day we need that fresh provision of God, and God provides. Now moving forward, we can also pray for God's forgiveness. Okay, but there is a connection to forgiving others. So the way Jesus taught this to us is, he said, forgive us our sins, or forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who have sinned against us, or those who are debtors to us, as we forgive. So there is a prerequisite. What is that prerequisite? When we walk in forgiveness, then when we pray for forgiveness, God is able to respond. Okay. But if we don't walk in forgiveness and we want God to forgive us, it doesn't work that way. And it's very clear in what Jesus himself taught. So he said, look, you keep your relationships in order. Don't walk in anger, bitterness, hatred, jealousy, envy, division, deception, lies. So many works of the flesh that we as believers also can have in our hearts. Remember, we said in the foundations for prayer that right heart attitude is required. So once our heart attitude is right towards people in our lives, then it's easy for us to approach God for our own forgiveness. Okay, so that's what. So we do our part. We set things right to whatever extent we can. And then when we come to the Lord in prayer, Holy Spirit, we know one of the functions or roles of the Holy Spirit is convicting the believer. So Holy Spirit will convict us of righteousness, sin, righteousness and judgment. So when Holy Spirit is speaking to me and saying, hey, this has to be corrected in your life, I respond to it. And when I respond to it, right, I act on it, then it's easy for me to say, okay, God, know the way I have forgiven that person, you please forgive me. So we must respond to the Holy Spirit. Okay, have our hearts clear, do our part, and then when we seek God to forgive us, we will receive his forgiveness, and we can walk with a clear conscience before God. And we said that, right? We said that when we have a clear conscience, when our heart does not condemn us, we saw that, then our prayers are effective. Our prayers are answered. God also hears our prayer. So that is the next part that you can cover in prayer. Now, then what else can we pray for in our pattern? The next verse here, verse 13 says, and do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. So basically, we are praying for God's leading. We are praying for God to guard us, protect us, right? Why? Because, you know, there's temptation out there in the world. Maybe there are some specific areas in which we ourselves struggle. Okay, so we just say, okay, God, you know, in those areas where the enemy can actually, have a chance to get me, I pray, Lord, that, you know, I will not stumble in those areas, right? So we go ahead and pray into those things. Okay, we could also, make declarations, we can cancel whatever the enemy may be plotting against us. We pray prayers like, okay, we come against the schemes of the evil one, we come against his plots, we cancel them in the name of Jesus, so that we don't have to go through, you know, unnecessary struggles, right? Getting into temptation. So this is more like praying for God to protect us and keep us on the right track, keep us walking in the path of righteousness. And that's what the Bible says. You know, God does not tempt us. He leads us in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. And we continue to ask God for that. And we say, God, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. So when we pray this prayer, we are asking God to help us guard our thoughts, help us guard our emotions, help us guard our actions, right? Our decisions, so many things. So you are inviting the Lord to work on everything so you keep aligned to the right path in God. So we could take some time to pray for this. Now, you might recognize, even as a family, there might be some weak areas for everyone. So we just pray and say, okay, Lord, you know, we are struggling in this particular area, which is a temptation for my household. We pray that you will cover us, protect us, grant us your wisdom, lead us, so on and so forth. So you take some time to pray that you would be delivered from the schemes of the evil one. Now continuing further, we are told to pray, yours is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen. Okay. So it is a prayer which starts with the adoration of God and it ends also with the exaltation of God. So we continue to recognize that, oh God, no, you are Lord, you are King, you are Master. So we give you thanks, we give you praise, and you spend some time exalting the Lord. And by now, you know, as you've been praying, you might also receive in your spirit that confirmation about a couple of things that you prayed, and you know that, hey, okay, God has already answered my prayer. I know by faith that I've already received it. So we may want to spend some time and say, oh God, thank you so much. You know, you have already heard my prayer. You are faithful. And I know that, you know, you are going to lead me in a triumphant victory in Jesus' name, and things like that. So you close off also with thanksgiving, with exaltation and worship. So in this manner, you know, we can use the pattern that Jesus gave us in the Lord's Prayer, and we can pray. You know, every day we could do this. Now, the length of the time, that's, you know, totally up to you. We'll come back to that aspect later on, where we talk about, you know, how do you engage in daily prayer? How should it be? You know, more specifics on that we will look at. But this is like a general pattern that we wanted to discuss at this point. So as you're hearing this, are there any comments or questions on the pattern that one can use in their personal prayer?
Nancy, I just
yes Divya. Yeah.
So while we are talking about this pattern of prayer, we see that we are trying to it's a little general, right? If I want to pray specifically, how do I make it specific. That's what I wanted.
So, see, Divya, it's like a template, okay? The way you would get a, let's say, a PowerPoint. You want to make a PowerPoint. You have some sites. You go there. They'll give you a template. In that, first slide will be introduction. Second slide will be, you know, the content, body, conclusion. So we're just using a template, but we personalize it. So based on my problem, I will include an introduction there. I will include the body. I will include the conclusion. So it'll be different for each one of us, Divya. So now, for example, if you take up the pattern, okay. So since you said more specific, so it'll apply to, you know, my personal life. So today, maybe I am experiencing some, maybe this week I've had some health issue. So as I'm praying, I begin by saying, you know, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you for your presence in my life. I thank you for your healing power. I thank you for sustaining me through the weakness. Lord, I thank you for providing, you know, help through family, through friends. Thank you for the encouragement which I have received. Thank you for the medical help. So you see, it's specific, right? So I'm just going into this pattern in a personal way. So then I might just want to continue on from there, and I might, you know, I'll take that kingdom, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So I would take some time to pray personally for myself and say, okay, Lord, I pray that in my health, Lord, let your kingdom come. I speak and declare complete wholeness in the name of Jesus. Lord, I speak health, I speak strength. In my physical body, I speak health and strength in my soul, oh God. Then, you know, I might want to cover, Lord, thank you for my work opportunities. I continue to speak that I will fulfill everything that you have called me to do in my ministry. So what am I doing? I'm kind of putting all my concerns and things that are relevant to me into that second category where I'm asking for the kingdom of God to come. So point is, the specifics depend on each individual and it depends on every day. But template is the same. Does it answer your question, Divya?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you. Okay, so Rosalind says, what about confessing word of God in prayer? Can the word of God be a part of our prayer? Like saying out loud few scriptures, like affirmations, can these also be considered in our prayer pattern? Or should I do these after my prayer? No, you can include it, Rosalind. See, for example, if you say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. You may want to say this as an adoration, isn't it? You may want to say this as an affirmation. Okay, great is our God. The voice of the Lord thunders. It is louder than the mighty waters. You're acknowledging the greatness and the goodness of God. So it could be a part of this pattern. Then again, as I began, I told us that this is not a rigid thing, right? Maybe one day you're sitting in prayer. Every day, this is helpful. If you want to use it every day also, we can use it, no problem. But maybe one day we are sitting for prayer and Holy Spirit is only leading us to pray for healing. Okay? So be open to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Don't get stuck up. So maybe one day you sit for prayer. And God just wants you to make confessions, declarations from scripture. Go ahead. Be led by the Holy Spirit. Right? So if you're strongly sensing the leading of the Holy Spirit, go in that direction. But otherwise, in general, this pattern is a good pattern to follow. And the Lord Jesus taught us this pattern. So, you know, we can use it. And Divya is saying, is the order followed in the pattern of the Lord's Prayer? Not necessarily, but you know, we like the, at least I like the part where God is the center of it all. Like you begin with God and you close off with worshiping God, and in between come all your needs and all your wants. So I kind of like the style in which it is already set. Okay, but yeah, if you go little off the sequence, I don't think God will be upset about that. Yeah. So good. You know, some nice questions here. How about the others? Anything that you are thinking? Okay. Anyone here, you use a pattern for your prayer time or?
Yeah, not a pattern of this sort, but yeah,
okay.
With it is kind of similar. Like I would worship and thank God. Yeah, so that, you know, even my perspective will be towards God. Mm. Yeah, and yeah, then come to the requests and pray about them. Yeah, and mostly conclude with like as if I've received, you know, what
okay.
I did. Yeah.
Nice. Thank you, Divya, for sharing your general pattern. How about the others? Do you use a pattern? Anyone else here? Okay, Zelitoli, not really. She says spontaneous. Okay, as the spirit leads for prayer. Okay, fine, Zelitoli. Yeah. Yes. Anyone else?
No pattern, ma'am. Even me.
Okay, Rosalind also just, you know, going by the
yeah, thanks, spirit. Adoration.
Okay.
Worshiping okay. God.
Yeah.
Just pray in the spirit.
Right. So, I think a lot of us, we don't really have a pattern, but then others we follow. Now, the Lord's Prayer is what Jesus taught us. So it's a very good pattern to follow on a daily basis. But I have also heard of Acts. Okay. Second. So Acts, I think some of you would have heard that this is basically adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. So some people follow this pattern. I have heard about tabernacle prayer. Okay, so tabernacle prayer is also similar to Acts, where you know, it's like outer court, inner court, holy of holies. So people say, in the outer court, it's more of confession because you come there and sacrifices were made for cleansing. So a lot of cleansing happens, and then, you know, you come into the inner court, and in the inner court, there is communion, there is revelation. So, you know, you kind of pray, you ask for your needs, to be met and all that. And then as you keep going deeper into the presence of God, you just worship the Lord in the Holy of Holies. It's all about, you know, God taking over. So there's a tabernacle pattern of prayers that some people recommend. So there are different patterns that people follow. These are only meant to be a guide. Okay, it's not like a strict rule. Okay, sorry, there's some disturbance. Yeah, so, right. So these are the other patterns. Jeffina, you want to share? You said you have a pattern?
Yes. I have a pattern where I schedule the prayers, like what we need to pray for today and what I need to pray for the next day, so that I make it for a week so that I don't forget to pray for everything in this life. And I, for a week, when the Monday starts, I write down the things which I need to focus more, like, if someone is sick, I need to pray for them regularly. So I make that. And I mark how many times I have prayed for that. Just to make me, you know, to continue the prayer life in a better way, not forget it. And that's why I do that.
Yeah, sure, Jeffina. Yes, Thank you for sharing that. So she schedules her prayers. For today, you know, I just want to leave us with this pattern, and it's a great pattern to follow in our everyday prayer life, and it just helps us to cover most of the normal, regular needs that you and I have, you know, it's easy. Like you will not miss out on the main things, okay? And the length of time, again, it's up to each of us. How long do you want to spend time worshiping the Lord before you bring your supplication? It's up to every individual, okay? Okay, so Lubega is asking, any more light with Acts? So Acts is, you know, each of these letters, they stand for the words that I mentioned to you. So A is adoration, then C is confession, T is thanksgiving, and S is supplication. Yeah, Lubega. So that's how some people like to spend time praying. I hope it answers your question. Okay, great. Yes, thank you. Yeah. So any more comments before we wrap up? Okay, so Sidkenu is asking, what is supplication? See, supplication, we talked about it, no? Sidkenu, when we said that there are different kinds of prayers, one of the prayers is supplication, where you earnestly ask God to do something. So it's a prayer of asking, okay? So that's what it is. Because in act, you're not asking God for anything. S in supplication, the way Jesus taught us to pray, you know, give us this day our daily bread, or forgive us our sins. So you're asking God, Lord, I need this. I earnestly want this. That's what comes into that category. Okay. Yeah. So Divya, a very honest comment there. She says, please pray for us students to learn these concepts and apply in our lives. Sometimes it's hard to live these principles out. Okay. Yeah, Divya. So as I told us, this prayer and intercession course should not become an informative course for all of us, right? So... Excuse me. As we are learning new things, we want to apply it, okay, in our everyday lives. So even something like praying in the pattern of the Lord's Prayer, that's not something I knew earlier. But after I learned that, yeah, you can actually pray like this, I incorporated it into my prayer life now. It's not to say that I always use this pattern, because sometimes, as some of you commented there, I am led by the Spirit. Sometimes the emphasis is different in the prayer times each time. But more or less, you know, covering the aspects that Jesus taught us to pray. Okay. So, yes, we must use it. That's the whole point of the course. Yes, Lubega, you have a question. Please unmute yourself. Please go ahead.
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Yes, Isaac, you can ask a question. I'm just waiting for Lubega in case he wanted to say something. Okay, he has his hand is not raised anymore. So please go ahead, Isaac.
Yeah, on the method of prayer. Yeah, uh-huh. I see, in the Catholic Church, most of the time they pray to the Holy Mary and the saints to pray to the Lord for us. And pattern of prayer is like praying direct to our Father. So how can we reconcile this? Because like in the our setting, we pray sort of pray direct. And in the Catholic Church, they pray through Holy Mary. Yeah, how can we reconcile this?
Yes, 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 Isaac. So, see, Isaac, we will go by scripture. We will go by, you know, what Jesus taught us to do. And this is what Jesus taught us to do. You pray to the Father in the name of Jesus. And that's what he told us, isn't it? So, we have basis to pray directly to God. Is there basis to pray to Mary? Is there scriptural basis to pray to the saints? There is no scriptural basis. So, does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think I believe in the direct prayer.
Yeah.
We are sons and daughters of God, so we ask him direct. Like if you want to ask your Father, you cannot go through another person to ask your Father for what you need.
Correct. Yes, you're right. Yeah, sure. Thank you. And we see today in the mentoring hour, as Pastor also shared, there was a question about those who die in the Lord. And he said, you know, as Paul stated, when I am absent in the flesh, I am present with the Lord. Okay. So for us to assume that once a saintly, you know, we may call them good person, righteous person, or a great person dies, we want to pray to them so they can supplicate to God on our behalf. That won't happen, because when they're absent in the body, they are present with the Lord, right? They're just in God's presence now, and they're no longer engaged in ministry. And they cannot, because the Bible doesn't say that, you know, there is any place where they can pray on our behalf or do something on our behalf. They can't. They're just with Jesus, and they will return when he comes back. So there's no biblical basis, Isaac, to pray to Mary or any of the saints or any believers who have died. Okay, so yeah, I think that is clear. All right, great. So Isaac is fine with that. Okay, we've gone over a few myths today. We will wrap up today's class, and we meet again tomorrow. So you can think this through, and if you have any additional questions, let's take it up tomorrow. So I would request one of us to please pray and close off today's class. Anyone? Please feel comfortable. Anyone can just unmute and pray, please.
Father, we thank you for the time you have given us to come before your presence and learn from your word regarding prayer and intercession. Lord, we pray that the lessons that we learned today we'll be able to apply in our walk with you in our prayer life, and we'll be able to bring forth into fruitfulness, O God. We ask you, Holy Spirit, Lord Jesus, to help us to pray, to intercede, to maintain that constant relationship with you, Lord. We're so grateful for all that you are teaching us. We humble ourselves once again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, John, for leading us. So, yeah, take care, everyone. And yeah, Robert seems to know today is John Paul's anniversary. So happy wedding anniversary, John Paul.
Thank you, Pastor.
And glad. How about one of us pray for you before we log off today's class? Divya, would you be able to please pray for John? John and his wife, Glads. It's their first your wedding anniversary.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for this happy moment, Father, Lord, in Brother John's life and Glad's life, Father Lord. We rejoice with them, Father, that you, Lord, bless them, Father Lord, with this 1 year of marriage. I pray, Father, that you shower, Lord, your blessings upon them, Father. And the, let their relationship be strengthened, Father. It may grow strong, Father Lord, just as, Lord, you desire, Father Lord. I pray that their family be rooted and grounded, Lord, in the foundation of Jesus Christ, Lord. I pray, Father, let your glory, let your grace, let your power, Father Lord, let your anointing, Father, be manifested, Lord, in their family. Lord, we bless them in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray, let there be love, joy, Lord, peace, prosperity, Father Lord, in their lives. I bless both of them, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Lord. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' precious name. We pray, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Divya, and congrats, John. John and Glad.
Thank you, Divya.
God
thank
bless.
You. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, brother.
Yeah, God bless.